en especial a mis compañeros y compañeras de la Comisión de Géneros y Sexualidades por toda su colaboración para hacer esto posible. Tilda Williams es de esas personas que claramente no necesita ningún tipo de presentación, es una referente ineludible del campo de los estudios de cine y audiovisual, en especial aunque no tan solo desde perspectivas de género, así que voy a ser muy breve. Es profesora emérita del Departamento de Film and Media and Rhetoric de la Universidad de Berkeley, ha escrito numerosos ensayos sobre lo que ella denomina género del cuerpo, como melodrama, pornografía y cine de terror, dos de los cuales se van a trabajar durante el transcurso de este taller. Para citar algunos de sus libros más conocidos, Figures of Desire, de 1981, que es su disertación sobre cine surrealista, investigaciones en torno a la representación del sexo en el cine a través de la historia, como Hardcore, de 1989, su compilación Pop Studies, de 2004, y Screen Sex, del 2008, y por último, su gran aporte, su invitación a repensar la noción de melodrama ya no solo como género, sino como un modo de la cultura popular, y ahí no podemos dejar de mencionar a Playing the White Scar, de Drama y Black and White, de 2001, On the Wire, que es un estudio sobre la serie aclamada de HBO, del 2014, y Melodrama Unbound, I don't know if I said it right, una antología coeditada con Christine Blecki, que va a ser publicada en el transcurso de este mes. Con respecto a la dinámica del bollo, al principio la profesora va a poner algunas ideas centrales, ¿sí?, de la temática que nos está convocando en el día de hoy, y después vamos a hacer algo mucho más interactivo, donde la profesora va a recoger las preguntas que hayan en la audiencia. También haremos un breve receso del medio, para descansar un poco, tomar aire, etc. Y bueno, sin más, damos comienzo al taller. Bienvenida, Tilda Williams, a la Argentina, y gracias por estar aquí.
Gracias de haber venido por discutir dos muy viejos artículos. Lo siento que mi español, lo siento que mi español no es bastante bien para decir todos en español. Because I'm going to be speaking in English, I will try to speak slowly, but please tell me if there's something I say, especially too fast, to stop and to explain. I'm very happy to do that. What I want to do is explain the thinking behind these two articles, why I have chosen now to work on melodrama, rather than body genres. In other words, I set out to write a book on body genres a long time ago, and I never wrote that book. So why is that? I think that's the main question I want to try to explain. And I should say that I've had the experience of reading the work of certain authors who I admire and going to hear them talk and hearing them say, well, I don't do that anymore. And I would always be very frustrated because I was interested in that. And they, you know, they said, well, that's passé, I don't do it. So I didn't like that, and I'm not going to do that today. I want to talk about why I did body genres, why they still fascinate me, and then why I have chosen to go in a slightly different direction. I think the secret to that is that in scholarship, one thing always leads to another. And you can take one direction, you can take another direction. And in this case, I took the melodrama direction. I want to try to explain why that is. But there are other directions. There are, you know, one thing just always leads to another. Am I doing this okay with the microphone? You can hear me? So in writing the body genres article, if you have it with you, I realize I'm not going to quiz you, but I did ask you. On the third page, I'm not going to be referring too much to the pages or anything, but you can see on the third page, the bottom right, that I was already aware when I wrote this essay that there was some sense in which melodrama didn't fit in the category of genre. Although many people, especially in the United States, and I would expect in South America, do think of melodrama as a genre. So I'm aware of that. But I do write on the bottom of page 3 that, and I'm referring to systems of excess, that it seems to me that melodrama might be a larger system of excess. And what I'm ultimately doing in the course of this discussion is showing how, in a way, I will discover that for me, melodrama is not an excess. Melodrama is actually the norm. That's the direction I'm going. And that's why I don't pursue body genres, including melodrama, because melodrama is too big for genre. Okay, so I even go so far in this passage as to suggest that melodrama might be that larger system of excess, except at that point, I think it stops being excessive. So the primary problem is that in my effort to stake a claim for the importance of embodied viewing and the body in well, in this case, genres, the spectacle of suffering as being one example of embodiment, the spectacle of fear being another, and the spectacle of shall we call it ecstasy, but we could call it other things as well. I decided to put aside, at this point, my own growing knowledge that melodrama was something more than a genre, and treat the three genres as if they were equal. And so that's sort of the premise of this essay. And it is, when I look back at this essay, I love this essay. And I think it's me at my smartest, but it's me at my cleverest, and sometimes I'm choosing to be clever rather than to pursue what is, to me at that moment, true. And that's always a danger in scholarship, right? That, oh, this sort of rhymes with that, and I can be clever. So especially with these temporal qualities that I discovered, I thought I had really discovered something too early for a horror film. It seemed to really work, or too late for melodrama, which makes everything. The problem with that, of course, is that a lot of melodrama is all about being in the nick of time. But I put that aside. Or on time, with the fantasy of pornography, where two bodies will be simultaneously ecstatic together. So I'll put that aside. I also, here's another place where I was clever, I think, rather than true, is the kind of forcing of the argument into liquids, that it's the blood of the female body when she is slashed. That's something that just came to me in the horror films I was looking at at that moment. It's not true of the whole history of the horror genre, which for various reasons there's not a lot of blood in, except now there's an incredible amount of blood. The liquids, blood, tears, and whatever, ejaculation, becoming wet, whatever you want to call it. So I was particularly eager, and this has to do with the fact that I was just finishing this book, Part 4. I had just written that book, and I sort of wanted to be the person who could say, this is a body genre, I'm sure. I have identified a body genre. Now let's look at other body genres. And I think there is maybe a bit of a quality or a desire to justify the study of what was considered too low to be worthy of any kind of scholarly study. But I think there was a price to be paid in this new categorization that I created insight from my son, you know, what disgusted him in the movie was with the idea of kissing or tears, you know. He was interested, he thought, in horror. Actually, he was scared to death of it, but he thought that was what he wanted to see. So in this workshop, what I want to do is read this essay alongside this other fairly popular, but also old article, Melodrama Revised, and considered here not as a genre, but as a mode, and to explore what mode means. So let me just say that it seems to me that there is a contradiction. They can't both be right, both of these articles. There's something inconsistent about the theorization or something like that. So let's turn to film bodies. And I want to try to just explain what fed into that and why I thought at the time that that was the most important thing to do. So this was 27 years ago that I wrote this essay, and I wrote it just after the hardcore book. I think it's worth asking, why did I think that these three genres seem to have a kind of outlying status? And I will ask you that question. What made them different than other genres or other ordinary films? Is that too hard a question? Aristotle has been very influential in telling us what respond to and imitate what it sees on the screen. And I noticed that today, arguments about pornography are still based on that idea. That idea that, in fact, in the New York Times recently, there was an essay using the Me Too movement, which I thought was very insidious, to say that we should ban pornography, starting over all the wars about banning pornography, because the young men of our American culture are just watching pornography and then imitating what they see. And that's still a powerful argument. So I chose these because they were supposedly mimicking, and in the long run, I think, in order to say that there was something more complicated going on than pure mimicry. So it seemed like what I was doing was paying attention to the excesses that had been neglected by film study and finding a new category for study. And the other thing is that I think these three genres seemed to be, I don't think they really were, but they seemed to be relatively new. It's horror at the time I was writing, it just blossomed as an area of study in the work of someone like Carol Clover. Is that work that you know that has been translated? How many of you have read Carol Clover? A few. Okay. Well, Carol Clover wrote a book called Men, Women, and Chainsaws, and she was writing about films like The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, which is the point where horror became very, very bloody, and you might say excessive. And she also brought, as other writers did, I did too, writing some early essays about horror. Think about the gendered nature. Why was it that the only woman who survived in horror film was the one who did not have sex, the babysitter who didn't have sex? Pornography also wasn't new, been around for a long time, maybe not since antiquity in the same sense, but it was pertinent and important at that moment because there were wars about pornography within anti-pornography feminism, anti-censorship feminism, and I was on the anti-censorship side. So melodrama was not new either. I would now say it was one of the most well-known categories, whether thought of as a mode or a genre, of the 19th century stage. It was dominant. And here, it was not just dominant because of the suffering of women, it was dominant because there was a lot of action to it, and there was a lot of pathos. And so, one of the things that I would begin to do in Melodrama Revised is to insist that we think about both pathos and action and not drop the action out of it. So, I was taking some very old categories that pre-existed in literature, Frankenstein on the stage, Pissarricourt, who was the first important melodramatist on the French stage, all the way through D.W. Griffith, at least, I would say, that was melodrama, and relating them to equally old but a more underground and illicit and for men only category called pornography. So I'm going to move backwards a little bit and explain something about why I thought pornography was the genre that needed to be explained before I turned to melodrama and them. And this has a lot to do with the discovery of this man. Does anyone recognize him? Yes? Who can say his name? Mybridge, very good. You can pronounce it in the correct American British way. Okay, so Mybridge was start to write about pornography. I mean, it was hard. How do you just start to write a book about pornography when Andrea Dworkin and Catherine MacKinnon were saying things like, it is the pornography is the theory and rape is the practice. That was a very, very important slogan of that particular time. So why would anyone want to write about pornography? Well, the way I came to it, because when people ask me, why did you write a book about pornography, I never said, well, I just decided it was important to write a book about pornography. I was writing a book that I called Body Genres. This is the book that I never wrote. And I conceived, I in fact wrote a nice little description of the project to get a fellowship in order to study this. I conceived that I would have a chapter on musicals, a chapter on pornography, and in fact the comparison between musicals and pornography was very, very enabling to me. But also early cinema at the point of its origin, when bodies were, you know, getting over, run over by an automobile, dismemberment in Méliès, all of that stuff that happens in early cinema, which is definitely about the body. And then, you know, I just tossed in pornography and horror as obvious genres that I would have an easy time writing about. And I started to write about pornography first because I thought it was the easiest, and that was my mistake. It turned out to be much more complicated and, I have to say, interesting than I thought it would be. It was actually working on the early cinema part, and in fact what some people call, I think it's a very cinema-centric way to do it, but to call it pre-cinema, as if there was the whole world of history and then there was cinema and then there's pre-cinema, which is a lot. This man, Myrick, he's pictured with a horse because he was the person who solved the question. And this is a very California issue. The governor of California was named Leland Stanford, and he wanted to know at what point in the fast trot of a horse you could see all 4 feet leave the ground. He thought that might be the case, but actually the naked eye could not see that. It's not possible to know if all 4 feet leave the ground. And so what that means is there was a kind of secret that was invisible to the naked eye that Myridge discovered through taking, fast enough film or short enough increments of time that would reveal in a photograph what the movement of the feet were, and that was a surprise to many people. In fact, there are many, he in his own lectures would show how artists had misrepresented the movements of horses. And you look at them today, they look wrong, but they did look wrong at the time, because this was a secret, a visual secret, that was only revealed in the 1980s. So, I mean, there's a lot to say about that, and I do say that in hardcore. But what he does is, not quickly, but the next decade, he becomes interested in the movements of humans. And this is where I began to make connections to pornography, or to sexual difference and to feminism. Because while Myridge would show you ordinary men moving, and in this case a man who's running, and if the man walked, he would just walk. But when he showed women walking, there was a strange thing that happened. Also, if a woman, take really detailed series of photos, and let's see how he moves. But when he wants to show a woman getting into bed, he actually defeats the purpose of motion study, because if you cover up the body, you can't see how it's moving. And yet he needed to do that for some reason. And why was that? Similarly, when he was showing us a movement of a woman, this is not a really impressive movement. It's going like that. But he poses her in this I would say, lascivious pose. And of course, we know that smoking at this time for a woman was, and we also know that the only woman he could get to pose naked were, in fact, prostitutes. Then the whole thing begins to connect up with pornography. I'm sorry, I didn't show you the smoking. There it is. Or he's invented, men could throw balls and do carpentry and fence and do all sorts of conventional things. But he decides that he's going to have this lovely woman, what's it called? Skipping across stones with a picnic basket and fishing pole. It is really very interesting. And so this enabled it's the fascination with seeing the secret thing that led me to turn to pornography. And I was of an age that I had seen the first public screening of pornography, Deep Throat. And at the time I thought, well, okay, so you're talking about fellatio and Deep Throat is all of it. If you don't know the film, this woman goes to see a doctor because she cannot have orgasms, and she discovers that her clitoris is in her throat. That is the silly premise, but I think also the very serious premise of this film. And so then the privileged sexual act turns out to be, in Deep Throat, not the usual kind of penetration, but so-called deep throat fellatio. Now, if you were an anti-pornography feminist and you saw something like this, you could say, this is torturing this woman. And a lot of people said that. I was more interested in why fellatio became an important sex act at this moment. Because everybody was writing about, novelists were writing about fellatio. It wasn't that it didn't exist, but what did it enable? Why was it suddenly, Linda Lovelace's face in relation to what would become the ejaculating penis? And you probably know that that's, even to this day, one of the major tropes of hardcore pornography, that there will be an ejaculating penis. And that will satisfy the viewer to know that orgasm, ejaculation, ecstasy has taken place. So what has happened? Does anyone want to say? Why? Are there too many of you to give answers? So I'll wait for the Q&A. Okay. The reason is, to use a Freudian term, it's displacement. The man wants to know the secret of the female body. And that body does not easily give up its secrets, because that external ejaculation in convulsive way, it is part of the body giving up, confessing its pleasure, is not visible or easily visible. I think scientifically you could say it could be made visible, and has, in fact, in pornography. But for cinematic purposes, just not very visible. in the female body. So how convenient for it to, she smiles after this, she's just spreading the ejaculate all over herself. And so in pornography, we are always going to be focused, you know, in any way, it's going to be the woman's body that is important, the woman's body that is differently marked, the woman's body who is being studied and scrutinized in a, and to use Foucault's term, in a kind of scientia scientific way. Okay, so that was my insight. That was what allowed me to say, oh, at the origin of cinema is the origin of pornography. Whew. Now I don't know if that, in fact, don't think that's exactly true, but it was it was one of those exciting things that allowed me to go full steam ahead and to study pornography. So okay, I'm through talking about pornography and body genres. Are there any questions about that part of it? No? Okay, I will continue. So, once again, we come back to these two essays. Was my guide, and Brooks, and how many of you have read Peter Brooks? I know he's not translated. Okay, so very few of you. This image, I'm sorry, I see two images, and so one of them. This is an image that Peter Brooks used in order to kind of condense all of the cliches about melodrama, and they're all here. It's actually a parody of melodrama by Daumier, the caricaturist, but it says it all. I think you understand what the cliches are. There's a woman who is all in white and who is being expelled. The man is pointing his finger and saying, out of my house, out of my life. And the audience, this is a theatrical audience, is responding to that, is moved by that. It was a good image to try to condense all of the qualities of melodrama into one cliche. And the book that explained melodrama better than any other book I had read was Peter Brooks' The Melodramatic Imagination. Should be translated into Spanish. So my definition, the definition that I come up with in this essay, is a definition that is based on the influence of reading Peter Brooks and the influence of also encountering an essay by Christine Bledel, who has subsequently become somebody with whom I collaborate, because she seemed like the one person who really saw what melodrama was beyond just the suffering woman's film. So I've just tried to summarize here some of the definitions of melodrama that I came up with in this essay, borrowing from Peter Brooks. So I'm just making it up as I go along, but according to my observations, studying women's films, but also knowing that melodrama was a mode, not a genre. And Peter Brooks is the person, oh, that's what I wanted to show, I'm sorry. Peter Brooks is the person, can you read this? It says, the melodramatic imagination, Balzac, Henry James, and the mode of excess. So for Peter Brooks, he saw that melodrama was a mode, not a genre. He was talking about 19th century stage melodrama, and then as a literary critic, he really wanted to make the case that was a little bit of a surprise to many people that Balzac was a melodramatist, not just a realist. Balzac was known for being, was especially famous for being realistic. In fact, well, I won't go into that. So, my attempt to define melodrama at this point is that Brooks said it was a mode born out, and why was there suddenly a new mode called melodrama on the French stage? Suddenly, at the beginning of the 19th century, what particular event might have influenced that? Well, as any historian would say, it's probably, especially if you're looking at French melodrama, it's the Revolution. And that what happened with the Revolution was that basically, for Brooks, in a nutshell, there was something called the loss of the sacred, the loss of the importance of the king. I mean, if you cut off the head of the king, that whole edifice of king, church, kind of disappears. Now, historically we know it didn't disappear, and so I was always a little skeptical of that argument, but I totally accepted the deigned and had exalted as the, in a way, the highest form of human imagination. So in looking at the melodramatic imagination, Peter Brooks says, okay, a new imagination comes on the scene, and that imagination is melodrama. So let me just go through these.
Can you see them?
Yeah. So melodrama seeks a hidden moral legibility. Now the reason he says it needs to be hidden is it's not apparent who is good and who is bad. Whereas in tragedy you could tell, you know, the king was supposed to be good, and then something might happen, and then good has to be reestablished. So moral legibility is no longer obvious, no longer the way the universe happens, because humans have been able to disrupt the proper way that things supposedly were happening. And so he uses this term moral legibility, which I used a lot in my subsequent writing. But I'm a little uncomfortable with it. I don't mean to say moral legibility in an absolute sense. This is always true. This is always bad. This is good. Rather, the moral legibilities are completely relative to one another, and they change all the time. So that word moral needs to be qualified. But the other thing that melodrama does is seize upon the social problems of everyday reality. Tragedy didn't do that. In fact, there's a critic of tragedy and melodrama who said, tragedy is not about the plague in Thebes. You know, why does Oedipus do everything that he does? Because there's a plague, and he needs to set things right, because he has done something very wrong. Melodrama is not about the social problem of a plague, or of social inequality, or any of the things that in the post-revolution we might care about. You could also say in the post-enlightenment. So it's okay to have a plague be the problem of a particular drama. And then I also, when I put LW there, I'm just citing myself. So I say that theatrical acting, Manichaean polarities, are not the essence of melodrama. That's one way of thinking about it. You know, if you think melodrama is always bad, then you say it is excess. It is bad overacting. It is overdrawn and everything. But I want to say that these qualities are the means to something more. And the way I put it here is the achievement of the felt good. In other words, you want your audience to come away, and this is not what you're supposed to come away with in tragedy. You want your audience to come away feeling that there's some kind of morality has been established, and that some kind of, I say, felt good. So there's the feeling of the audience, which is very, very important, and that's often the action side of melodrama, as well as the pathos side of it. And so I try to pronounce, we must study melodrama as melodrama, not as a form that wants to be something else. Maybe you've read the essay by Thomas Elsasser. It's called Tales of Sound and Fury. He was an important critic and theorist of melodrama. And the idea at heart was that melodrama is failed tragedy. Something that Aristotle could understand, but not something that I want to understand. clear that she is as innocent as she looks. And so there are all these problems the melodrama is seeking to solve. And in its machinations of plot, often very, very unrealistic, it will solve. And then, so that leaves me with this problem. What isn't melodrama? Slapstick comedy? Realism unmixed with moral, moral categories? It's so large that I frankly don't know how to study this. And how do I write a study about melodrama? So that's the problem. The solution is not entirely there, but in the process of writing this essay, I come up with I call them axioms. I think I don't know if I call them axioms here, but in the book that I eventually wrote on this, I call them axioms. I think that's a little too eternalizing. I think that it's actually what I would call hypotheses. So let me soften that. So the first is, and I'm borrowing from Brooks and I'm borrowing from Christine Bledel in order to say these are the five qualities of melodrama. First, that it begins and wants to end. It doesn't necessarily manage that, but it wants to end where it starts. I mean, you can imagine that that woman who's being expelled from the stage was at some point in a happy place. Let's say there was a party going on, and she was with her family, and everything was right with the world. So melodrama will interrupt that. Evil will come in. I sort of love melodrama because American politicians have taken in recent years to talking in terms of good and evil. This didn't used to be the case. I don't think Franklin Roosevelt did this, but now we have a president, and we actually, the axis of evil was a term that was introduced by George Bush. My insight looking at melodrama was that the political language of today has become the language of melodrama, and that was an important insight to me. Two victim heroes. That victims are important, but heroes are too. And that in male-centered, like an early, I wrote about Rambo. Rambo has to suffer in order for us to believe in his virtue. I mean, it's kind of a sick idea, but it's true. Anybody who suffers. I mean, why do the madres and abuelas Plaza de Mayo have Plaza Mayor. Why do they have moral clout, moral power? It's because they have suffered. This is a basic insight of melodrama. I don't think Oedipus has moral power because he suffers. He has moral power before he suffers. And he sort of loses it with the suffering. Did you want to say something?
I agree that it's not a real test anymore. You have to suffer to recognition, belief, the virtue.
Yes.
The other way.
Yes.
Post-revolution.
Post-revolution, exactly. Okay, so the moral legibility comes with the recognition of the virtue of the good person, the person who has been persecuted. And then here I'm trying to say, let's not just go into women's film, let's not a genre either. Okay, so this is why melodrama is always pertinent, because it can adapt to new problems, new social problems. Women can't have property. You know, why is all that problem about the deed to the ranch or to the house? It's because the woman isn't allowed to own it herself. And then finally, this is Brooks's idea that characters embody something that is primary and psychic. The father, the brother, the wife. In other words, people tend to be types that represent certain kinds of things. But if it's also adapting with realism, then these can become more psychologically varied. The melodrama is never stuck. And so it seems to me that the thing about melodrama is that we always recognize the bad old melodrama. I was writing this book when Titanic came out, and there were so many arguments saying, well, it's sort of a melodrama bunt. It's a good melodrama. It's realistic. It's, you know, it's all of these things. And that's true. And that's why we almost never, the film we like is not a melodrama. It's realistic. And that's why I eventually wrote a book on The Wire, because at the time, that seemed to be the most realistic American melodrama about race, whose creator, David Simon, refused to call it a melodrama and said it was a great tragedy. And so I fought with him over that notion. Okay, so I then wrote this book. Melodrama was too big to tackle as an, you know, where do I start with melodrama? Well, you can start with one film and show it's a melodrama, but that's actually not very interesting. It's too easy to do. So what I did is I took a chunk of really important American experience, what I call the melodrama of black and white, and I was writing this book at the time of the O.J. Simpson. I was personally angry as a white woman that this black man was getting away with murder. And it is pretty well recognized today that he did get away with murder. But I had to recognize in myself that if I was angry, there was a strong reason for that, you know, and it probably was a racist reason, you know, going back in the history of American culture. So I took this idea. The article you read, I wrote right in preparation for writing this book, which I'm not boring you with, but it is a book about, I called it playing the race card because that was a term that was used in the O.J. Simpson trial that said, oh, if you bring up race, then you're just going to automatically unleash all of that black anger at the way blacks have been treated, and white anger at the uppityness of blacks. And so in the subtitle, I put melodramas of black and white from Uncle Tom to O.J. Simpson. So what I wanted elect people, and therefore for the recognition of virtue of slaves as human beings. So it was a very important work for me. And what's to the right of Uncle Tom's Cabin? Does anyone recognize what that is? It's a very, very important American film. Okay. It's Birth of a Nation, D.W. Griffith. And this is what I didn't do in the essay I gave. I didn't get into the real interest of D.W. Griffith. The real interest of D.W. Griffith is that in writing, in making what was the most important film of the first half of the 20th century, the play Uncle Tom's Cabin was the most important play of the mid-19th century. It was called a melodrama. Everyone called it a melodrama. Birth of a Nation took that original premise of the suffering black man and reversed it and gave us black men like this man here who is about to rape Lillian Gish. That's as evil as you can get. This was my way, and then, you know, I went to all the way up. I traced the melodrama of black and white in American culture up to the trial that was happening as I was writing, where a black man got away with murder of a white, blonde woman, and the races were just absolutely polarized over that trial. You couldn't watch that trial in the company of black people if you were a white person. It was quite extraordinary. All right, so I wrote that book and really got into the racial issues, and that seemed to be a way to handle, from my American perspective, melodrama. It would be a whole different situation in South America, I'm sure. So I'm almost to the end. Here I just summarize a few more ideas. I try here, before writing the black and white melodrama book, I try to define melodrama as a mode, not a genre. I try to say that modes are bigger categories than genres, and I try to say, well, this is my reason for not. When I use Way Down East in this essay as typical melodrama, I'm purposely steering away from the racial issues that I know are going to take a lot of discussion in the next book. All right, so where to go next? I wrote that book. The thing that, you know, there's the thing that isn't clarified, that isn't quite done enough. And for me, the thing that was not clarified in this previous book is the question of how to define mode. We know what genre is. At least I think we know what genre is. Some people say that melodrama, silent cinema is nothing but melodrama, and a lot of people accept that. It's one of the reasons I totally love silent cinema, and also because of the mellows, the music that goes with it. Brooks, here's how Brooks defines melodrama. As an aesthetic, okay, a mode of the modern imagination, a cultural form, a semantic force field, an outlook, a style, a sensibility, a rhetoric, so broad that again you end up asking what isn't the melodramatic mode. And so this has been sort of the problem, the stumbling block for me going forward. put genres below mode, that mode generates particular genres in particular areas of problems. But it's more like a motor rather than something that you can actually clearly define itself. I mean, obviously I've been trying in previous work. So they do involve, however, a kind of primary need of dramatizing experience, and not just eternal experience of kings, but ordinary experience. That seems to work. They involve the primary need of drama. So then, on the plane, I'm coming here. That's where I was going to leave it. I'm reading this wonderful essay by, well, an essay that I like, by Agustin Zarzosa, called Melodrama and the Modes of the World. This is an essay, is anyone familiar with it? This is an essay that I, that was published in English in 2010, a while ago, and this person went on to write a book that was a Deleuzean study of melodrama that I don't like, and that I can't really understand. But this essay seemed to me to make some progress on this problem, because he wants to define modes. In other words, it has been a very vague term in Brooks, and me, and everyone. Modes are a strategy to solve practical problems of experience. They are not overarching conceptions of the world that inform artistic works. If that's true, then what I said before is not correct. Fictional works need modes because we are the protagonists of our own fictions, which is perhaps maybe not true for Oedipus or for other figures of tragedy. We can't define the melodramatic mode in terms of the ideas it employs. And so he defines melodrama as a mode that, in order to ameliorate suffering, tests the efficiency of ideas. That leaves me a little cold, but suffering doesn't. It seems to me that that's one of the key ideas that we've been talking about all along, that melodrama is about suffering. It is about suffering that, say, the Plague and Thieves causes. It's not about setting things right, it's about dealing in some way with that suffering. And one of the problems with melodrama is that the easy, happy ending is just a kind of finessing of the problem. It's not the real, it's never the real solution. But nevertheless, a problem is being addressed in melodrama, and Zarzosa wants to say that it is suffering. Now, he goes on to say a number of other things, but I think I just want to leave it there. He's a Hegelian, and he looks at Hegel and the story of bondage and slavery and bondage. But that all works with me very well because of Uncle Tom and Birth of a Nation. So I just want to leave you with this idea that if we're going to talk about melodrama, that suffering is crucial, suffering wasn't a problem before, and that's where I want to go, maybe to refine it. Melodrama is about democratic post-enlightenment hope that suffering can be averted. And that's all I want to say. That's probably enough. Yes. Wow. That was long. Okay, I'm sorry. Should we have a